Hello, everybody. Welcome to our webinar today on higher education's leading role in cross-sector climate action. My name is Tim Carter. I'm president of Second Nature. We do have a full agenda here, so we're going to get started right away. One of the reasons why we wanted to present to this audience was really to talk about the work that's been happening over the past year, and then also preview a bit about what the future is to come on this cross-sector work. So go ahead to the next slide. Second Nature does this these sorts of webinars for a long time, and we do it with support of our corporate partners as well as many members of our network. So just a thank you to them before we get started. Next slide. And a quick note about our mission. Some of you may not be familiar with Second Nature as an organization, but we have been around for about 25 years. For the past decade, we focused on climate action specifically and building a network of institutions that have aggressive climate targets. And so we do accomplish our mission in two ways. And we like to talk about it as in higher education accelerating climate action and through higher education accelerating climate action. So in higher education, we run a program called the President's Climate Leadership Commitments. And these are commitments that are made by the senior leader of an institution, a president or a chancellor, on behalf of the institution. And it's not just a declaration that they take climate seriously, but it's actually a commitment to action. When presidents and chancellors commit to one of these commitments, they commit to carbon neutrality or increasing their climate resilience as a campus. And then they set out on a path to meet those goals. So what we do as a network organization is support all the campuses that have made those presidential commitments. And we have a network of around 600 schools that have done that right now. And many of the states across the country, our activities are both technical in nature as well as convening in nature. So the in work has been going on for the past decade. Recently, we adjusted our mission actually in the past number of years to include this through work of higher ed. So not just can campuses become carbon neutral or increase their climate resilience and within the sector do that, but how could the strengths of the sector actually be leveraged effectively to accelerate climate action? And that is something that actually expands the scope of what we do, not just internally to the sector, but also with other partners. And much of the focus today is really to understand what that work does and could look like moving forward. So one of the big examples most recently, Gina is going to talk about in a second, and that is with leaders and business and mayors and other civic leaders taking climate goals of the nation really seriously, and in some ways thinking about the role that higher ed plays in those climate goals for the international community and our own local stakeholders. I'm thinking about it differently and maybe actually changing the way that higher ed works in order to accomplish these broad societal goals. We think that's core to what higher ed's mission is as a sector, that it serves something more than just its own internal operational targets or its own internal constituents, but it has a broader social mission to both educate and lead the nation. And I think this through work for climate action is one of the ways it can do that. So next slide. So just to walk through the agenda today, we're really focused on, we have three main sections here. The first is with Gina Stovall. She is a staff member of Second Nature, and she's gonna be discussing the work of America's Pledge and We Are Still In. Then we have two of our leaders from our campuses, Heidi Van Gendren and Phil Valco, who are going to talk about the University Climate Change Coalition. And then Stephen Ellis from our staff will talk about resilience work, which inherently brings in community input and relationships in a different way. So that's the general arc of the webinar. Some of the technical details here, on the right side of your webinar screen, you'll see a tab that says questions. So throughout, we're going to take a break at each of the speaker topics at the end of the sections and have time for questions. So we're not going to wait until the end. We're actually going to do it at the end of each person's speaking section so you don't forget and then try to remember at the very end. So on the questions tab on the webinar, please fill in your question and we'll do our best to answer those during each of the sections. I think Gina has one slide that's actually a poll. So again, be paying attention for that as we go along. But without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to Gina Stovall. So you can go on to the next slide. Gina is the cross-section climate action manager, cross-sector climate action manager for Second Nature. So Gina, take it away.
Yes. Hi, everyone. This is Gina. Thank you so much, Tim. So as the slide in front of you shows, I'll be talking about America's Pledge and We Are Still In. They're two campaigns that are about a little over a year old now. And they're part of the cross-sector work that Second Nature has been doing with the higher education sector. A few of the things that I'll be talking about are the differences between America's Pledge and WASI, aka We Are Still In. I might switch between those two. And because they do work in conjunction with each other, so I'll share a bit about the functional differences. And then their accomplishments over the past year. And then a new campaign by WASI called the We Are Taking Action campaign. And then I'll end with a bit of information about the Global Climate Action Summit, which is happening in California in September. So next slide. So America's Pledge is an effort launched by Mike Bloomberg and California Governor Jerry Brown to make sure that carbon reduction efforts of the U.S., like subnational level, are actually being quantified and communicated to the world. This initiative started after the U.S. government backed out of the Paris Climate Agreement about a year ago. And since then, U.S. states, cities, businesses, colleges and universities, and so many other actors have been emerging as the new face of American climate leadership. And they've been stepping up with very significant and impactful commitments to reduce their carbon emissions. So America's Pledge really just wants to make sure the rest of the world understands that and understands we are still working towards these Paris goals. As I said, it formed after the Paris Climate Agreement and showcases to the world that the majority actually of Americans are committed to Paris and mitigating climate change, cutting their carbon emissions. And then they really functionally act as the aggregator and analyzing different climate solutions that we can be doing from the bottom up and communicating those actions. Next slide. So the difference between We Are Still In and America's Pledge, like I said, America's Pledge takes the data gathered and measures the US progress towards reaching the goals of Paris, while We Are Still In directly engages with non-federal actors. So all of the colleges and universities, businesses, the public sector, different city groups and cities and states. And they act as the connector to connect them locally to one another and also helps to access the data, which we'll talk a bit more with the We Are Taking Action campaign in a bit. Next slide. So this slide simply shows the importance of measuring at the subnational level or non-federal level and the magnitude of it here in the US. Even though the federal government may not be pushing any climate actions right now, the non-federal actors are doing a lot. And so if you look here, actually of everyone who's in America's Pledge and We Are Still In, that accounts for half of the US economy and population. And next. And then if you were to aggregate all of that, it would actually constitute the third largest economy in the world after the US and China. So it really just exemplifies how important this non-federal action is. Next slide. So a few of the things that America's Pledge has been doing over the past year and some really exciting upcoming reports include the phase one report that was released a few months back, and it shares a few of the non-federal policies that are already in existence and some near-term like opportunities to step up action. Next week, actually, a week from today, there will be an opportunity agenda that's released that again emphasizes some very actionable, high ambition, bottom-up opportunities. And then in the fall, the phase two report, which does more of the aggregation and analysis, will be reported. And so as non-federal actors continue to make these ambitious commitments and advancements on climate, America's Pledge will analyze these contributions and then just keep setting these roadmaps and sharing opportunities. Next slide. And so I'm going to end the America's Pledge section just on this 1 year later. There's a really cool microsite, oneyearlater.americaspledgeonclimate.com, that shares a lot of what's been going on just in the past year. And so if you are really a stickler for the data and the facts and specific actions, I highly recommend checking that out. Next slide. So now we're going to talk about We Are Still In. We already know kind of the difference between America's Pledge and We Are Still In. We Are Still In is the coalition driver. They're the connectors. Next slide. And in the past year, similar like accomplishments as America's Pledge. So We Are Still In, or WASI, has engaged over 2,800, I think the number has actually gone up since these slides were created, non-federal actors across all 50 states. And they serve as the connector in regions across all kinds of cross-sector climate action. Next. So currently, their latest campaign is actually the We Are Taking Action campaign. Next slide, which I'm going to explain just a bit more. The We Are Taking Action campaign collects climate action contributions via a very simple online platform. These contributions will provide a window into the scope and depth of American climate action and also help to determine where there are opportunity gaps at the local and national level. They'll be posted on the WASI website, and WASI will actually showcase them at the Global Climate Action Summit and also at the climate talks in Poland. So there's an opportunity to really talk up what your institution is doing. Next slide. Thank you. And so reporting to the WASI contribution platform is super simple, as I mentioned. If you're already reporting your climate action plans and your targets and your inventories to another site, you can just repurpose that and stick the link in there. So for instance, the Second Nature reporting platform, you just take the link to your dashboard and you copy and paste it here. Next. There's a nice little screenshot. So that blue box, you just paste it there. And if you'd like, you can add additional information. You can upload your climate action plans and things like that. So that covers the first of three questions that the contribution platform is asking, which is, what are the climate actions you're currently taking? The second question, they want to know, what additional climate actions are you able to or want to do? And then the third is, what support do you need to achieve that higher action? You know, how do you take things a step further? And they have devised a really cool way of deducing that information and hopefully fostering some cross-sector collaboration in your areas. So next slide. So here are just a few resources that are available to you. They have lots of resources on how to submit your contribution to the platform. But what I find most interesting next is that you're able to identify some collaborative opportunities. So there are a few that are preset. It's like a simple survey. So if you're interested in the utility sector and you'd like to work with utilities or you'd like to work with the public sector, you can identify those. And what WASI and America's Pledge will be doing is connecting like-minded groups together and cultivating potential partnerships and other collaborations in the next few months. Oh, next again. Okay, great. And so this is where I actually want to do the poll and see if people would be interested in these collaborations. We have a quick question for you. And let's see if I know how to launch this. There we go. All right, so these are a few of the options in the reporting platform, in that contribution platform. So you could select as many as you like or more. And also, and we'll give this just about 30 seconds or so for you to... Oh, I see some really cool ones going in. But you can also write in the actual WASI contribution platform, you can write in things that you're interested in if none of these suit you. Okay, seems to have died down. So let's see the results. And wow, it looks like a lot of people are interested in a lot of things, which is awesome. So yeah, I highly, highly recommend that you check out the WASI website. Be sure to complete your contribution. As I said, it's a pretty easy lift. And take advantage of this opportunity to potentially connect with other people in your area on these issues. All right, next slide. So last but not least, I will be talking about the Global Climate Action Summit. So on September 12th to 14th, Governor Jerry Brown of California will bring together people in San Francisco from around the world. The theme is Taking Ambition to the Next Level. Maybe you've heard about this summit. It's also called GCAS, so I might be switching between that as well. But the summit will showcase some of the leading climate efforts that cities, states, businesses, universities and colleges, investors, pretty much from all parts of society have been doing, and celebrating some of those amazing achievements and also highlighting some really great examples of leadership. Next slide. One of the events we want to alert you to is the We Are Still In Day at GCAS. It's going to be held at the California Academy of Arts and Sciences and is focused on implementation and coalition building. And so that's on September 12th, especially for We Are Still In signatories who want to convene ahead of the summit and really start connecting with one another. The format is currently a meeting slash workshop with the purpose of building those connections and identifying opportunities for collaboration, and then discussing how they can best localize these efforts. A few other events that have come to our attention that we'll be sharing with the rest of the network and all of the all of you is Science to Action Day, which is focused more on the climate science and how to use that with climate in policy decisions. And then there's also an Education Day, which is strictly education and educating people on climate change, specifically in K through 12 and higher ed. And then the campus carbon pricing event, which is a really exciting event if you're interested in establishing that for your campus. And then the last thing is the main stage program, which is what I mentioned earlier. It's really more of a showcase for 2 days. This is invitation only, but there are going to be over 500 affiliate events taking place. So if you're not at the main stage event, there's still tons of other incredible opportunities at GCAS for you to participate in. Next slide. And so the last thing I'm going to leave you on is I would love to know if you're attending or someone from your institution is attending GCAS. If you know of any great events that are happening, we at Second Nature are putting together a guide on how you can participate, not only in San Francisco, but also possibly remotely. So please feel free. My contact information is going to be on the next slide. Let us know. Or if you're interested in participating in those events and you need more information, also reach out. And yeah, that's all I have. I know it was a lot of information, but I think we're going to open it up for a few questions if we had any.
Thanks, Gina. And feel free, like I said, if you see the section on the right where the questions are, go ahead and fill that in. Gina, I was just going to ask you one thing. So we have this group of higher ed institutions that are part of We Are Still In, and the opportunities you showed are really kind of a collective effort. Have you seen, based on your work with the campuses, different ways in which they've been engaging within this collective effort in different ways based on, you know, ways you've seen them act in the past, and now that you've taken on this position, what sort of changes have you seen taking place within higher ed?
Within the We Are Still In coalition specifically?
Yeah, because this framework exists, are you hearing different conversations from people, or, you know, is there different levels of interest with engagement? You know, what sorts of changes have you seen over the past few months since you've been on board?
Absolutely. I think one of the biggest things is an attitude shift that higher ed only operates within higher ed, and you can definitely feel the need, like the interest in collaborating with the public sector in particular, but also with other nonprofit groups. There have been some really cool coalitions that have actually spawned out, like sub-WASI coalitions and groups, and what's happening at the local level in cities in particular, very, very fascinating.
Great. I think we'll hear more about that. Great. So let's go ahead and keep moving. Gina, you want to introduce our next?
Absolutely. I think we did have one quick question. I'll just let you know. The presentation will definitely be made available after with all of these links. So, yes. So, yeah, our next section is going to be on the University Climate Change Coalition, and that will be presented by Heidi Van Gendren.
Hi, everybody. I'm Heidi Van Gendren, and I'm talking to you from Boulder, Colorado, where it's a balmy 95 degrees today. My pleasure to speak to you about the University Climate Change Coalition. I am the Chief Sustainability Officer here at the University of Colorado in Boulder, and come to this position after spending roughly 30 years plus on doing just what Tim referenced earlier when he talked about the roles of universities as a convener. And whether I've worked in the public sector, the private sector, the NGO sector, and the university sector, and would note that the universities, colleges and universities are distinctly positioned to be more of a neutral convener to bring those key sectors together. And in this case, just to give you a quick background, the University Climate Change Coalition was in fact an inspiration of Janet Napolitano, who is the president of the University of California system. And when the current president of the United States withdrew from the Paris Accord, President Napolitano turned to her staff and said, we need to step up our game at the subnational level and exercise the power and responsibilities held by the university systems to bring those key sectors together in spite of a lack of action at the federal level. So the University Climate Change Coalition was born, and it is currently a coalition of 15 research universities across North America, and we're all committed to scaling up science-based climate solutions and have a fair amount of expertise on the climate science side, but also on the applied side for how those actual solutions are demonstrated, deployed, and successfully imbued into our society. And obviously, you know, the core purpose is fairly evident in days like today here, I'll say. Next slide, please. Again, the opportunity, and we certainly find this here in Boulder, to use our convening power and work specifically in coalition with the city of Boulder, in our case, the county of Boulder, the 52 counties in the state of Colorado. Certainly the private sector is a key player in that as well, and the NGO community as a very important, as Second Nature knows, a very important player as well. Next slide. The current members reach from are North American, but reach from Canada all the way down to Mexico. And I'll give a quick pause just so you can scroll through the inaugural 15 members. It's a nice geographic array. What's certainly an interesting aspect of the work that we're all doing on both mitigation and adaptation in the climate realm is where we are locally located. And interesting to have a coalition of partners in this case who may have different attributes in each of those locations that are actually applicable or not in the exchange of best practices. And that's a big part of the mission of the University Climate Change Coalition is in fact the exchange of best practices, which I have to say in the 30 years of work that I've done on trying to advance low carbon solutions, we're not altogether great about sharing best practices. And I may actually depart this lifetime still confounded by that, but I hope not. Next slide, please. Near-term objectives for the University Climate Change Coalition, when each of us were approached initially about joining the coalition, we were asked if, as a commitment, that to commit to convening a cross-sector forum in the first year of the coalition's existence. So we have begun to do that. I know that we're hard at work on a leadership forum on climate solutions that'll be coming up in July, later July for us, that will in fact have a relatively small collection of leaders from the private sector, the NGO community, the public sector importantly, and with the university as the convener of that, with a smattering of participants in the in academia as well, who will be really looking specifically at advancing, continued advancement of in the ground projects that that are either impeded or not by existence of public policy. So there's a policy component to our discussion. There is certainly an immense focus on the capital investments that we face in order to bring about this miraculous low carbon future, and with a specific focus on innovative financing. So there are many, many components to this. Obviously, our university also views our role as a living learning laboratory as new technologies are developed, with the demonstration and the deployment and the proof of concept, essentially, that gives us an opportunity to contribute to as hopeful broad-scale commercial viability of genuine, scalable, low-carbon technologies advance. So we've got a couple, next slide, please. For those of you from universities and colleges that may be considering joining the University Climate Change Coalition, there are five key components to it that you'll see on the right side of the slide that you're viewing. There are liaisons. We've working with Second Nature structured a liaison construction within the university that actually gives people within the university the chance to know one another, which I find, having come back into a university setting just about a year ago, was something that I was reminded that we continually need to build those bridges between the operations side, the communication side, the academic side, and certainly that external side of outward facing as well. Next. So we built the institutional consensus internal to the university as we then work to identify the cross-sector forum that each university will help hold, okay, right? And each of the universities, there have been five, we'll get to that in a minute, convenings that have taken place, but each of the 15 will hopefully do so pretty close to a timeline that will have those all having taken place by the Global Climate Summit that Gina described earlier. We have, as part of UC3, NEXT, so where we share knowledge across the institutions through a monthly meeting and coalition networking event that Second Nature nicely facilitates for us. We also, through the convenings and through those calls and exchange of information amongst the members, are evaluating our internal research priorities respectively among the members and looking at gaps that may exist and where the next frontiers are, as well as further depth in research that needs to occur. And then last but not least, certainly, we're all the way down to building that cross-sector partnership that hopefully will be ongoing. I know that the University of Colorado Boulder, truthfully, has been in that business for some time in close partnership with the community in which we reside and beyond, and I suspect that that's true for a number of the member organizations, universities thus far, but it can never be emphasized as to the power that brings and the care and feeding that it requires in order to have that coalition at the ready to respond to specific opportunities that arise. Next slide. We've talked about the next steps in terms of, there you go, sorry, I'm a lousy participant here, in terms of, all right then. So again, there have been five forums held, and I wanna just bring a couple of highlights. The cross-sector forum held by State University of New York, you're probably at Stony Brook, which is one of 64 campuses in the state of New York. It reminds me of how relatively unpopulated the state of Colorado remains. SUNY Stony Brook hosted the 10th annual energy conference, which brings New York state agencies together with public and private groups from across New York state. And they had a successful cross-sector forum that is an annual event, actually, that they were able to capitalize on for their participation in UC3. They have about 20 other universities and research labs. Research laboratories are a big partner for us out here as well. the 17 national labs that are spread across the country. If any of you are proximate to those, great resources if you're not already connected. And SUNY Stony Brook brought those folks together as well, and they discussed a variety of issues ranging from increasing efficiency to building resilient grid infrastructure. Heaven knows there's no lack of topics when you look at the array of climate solutions. Next slide, please. The Ohio State University hosted three events across 2 days to raise awareness and discussion about climate change and impacts in central Ohio and across Ohio. They had a research forum on building resilient communities in a changing climate. On the adaptation side, we are all looking at, in fact, resiliency as a key strategy, that with the expectation that continued severe weather events will not only occur, but likely occur more frequently with greater severity. How do you rebuild and or build actively to think about resiliency? They had a health forum at OSU that looked at climate change, health, and you. The health aspects of climate change, I think, are a key strategy that is coming along more strongly now, and perhaps can help supersede any unfortunate politics and political divides to remind us that there literally is common ground, regardless of how you may politically identify yourself on the issue of climate change. And finally, they had a public outreach event as well, the Ohio State West Fest, which was sounded like a raucous sustainability and outreach festival. So that was terrific as well. Next slide, please. Looking forward, there will be a progress report discussing the first phase of these convenings that have been held across the current participants in UC3. And in 2019, there will be a synthesis report that will bring together all of the good actions identified and frontiers yet to be broached successfully in a synthesis report. And importantly, cohort 2 will be opened up to all North American research universities in the hope that many more will come into the University Climate Change Coalition as we build it, perhaps beginning with North America, but with the potential for a global coalition that can really do some remarkable work. And we invite you, if you have interest, if you're representing a university on the webinar today, to please contact Gina Stovall for more information. And she will, she's been a terrific addition to the University Climate Change Coalition, along with the good work of Second Nature, and really invite you to come on in. As we said, everybody out there, come on down, for those of you old enough to remember that game shows on TV. My pleasure to stop talking now and turn the microphone over to the most recent addition to our little coalition here, and I'd like to introduce the Assistant Vice Chancellor for Sustainability at Washington University in St. Louis, Phil Volko. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, Heidi. Well, hello, everybody. I will talk just very briefly about the work that we've been doing in St. Louis and how it fits with the UC3 coalition. So our institution has been working with a range of cross-sector partners for a series of years. Within our region, we've got about 5 or 6 higher ed institutions of different sizes and scales. And a few years ago, we realized that we were all putting a lot of effort into planning and hosting events and largely competing for a similar audience and not necessarily achieving any specific outcomes. So we started a process of envisioning one big shared event, which we pulled together last April, the One STL Sustainability Summit. And this event had, I think, maybe 10 partner organizations that were hosting, all contributing planning resources and funding. And the very specific focus of it was to develop measurable targets for the 8-county St. Louis region in the six categories that you can see on the screen. Energy and emissions, transportation, water and green infrastructure, and so on. So the image on the right is from the second day of the summit, where each of those topic areas bulleted on the left, we had a group of local experts that sat together very intensively through a thoughtful facilitated process to draft those targets and to draft potential strategies. Next slide, please. And the intent of the work was really to begin to build out essentially a shared destiny for our region, for our 8-county St. Louis region. So as many of you are familiar, traditionally institutions like ours, like yours, will adopt goals, will adopt strategies. The cities that we sit within will do the same. Some of the businesses in our regions will do the same. And the intent of this effort was, even while there are going to be these separate goals, is to create a shared agenda for the region, that all of our shared goals will nest under that shared agenda. So since the summit, we've spent a fair amount of time building infrastructure, and we have created an endorsement page, onestltargets.org, which actually isn't really publicly launched yet. We just went through a final round of edits on it. You're welcome to check it out and see what it looks like. But the intent is now to pivot from the local experts developing the targets to building buy-in around the targets. At the same time, we were able to leverage the student and faculty expertise and work to create the first regional greenhouse gas inventory. Similarly to the goals that are set, inventories are usually done at smaller scales. So to be able to have an 8-county region that can help inform where we should focus our efforts is a really great asset that we're still in the process of refining. And the energy emissions component of the effort has 4 subgroups focused on energy efficiency, which will largely be building related, energy source, transportation, and data and analytics. Next slide, please. So that brings me to UC3. We've been doing this work for a couple of years, but UC3 really presented this great opportunity to formalize the work and to pull in executive leadership. Our chancellor, Mark Wrighton, saw the announcement about UC3 and was incredibly excited about having our university join. And as we've talked about, what does our involvement look like and how do we build on the effort that has already been underway, it's creating this really wonderful moment of engagement where we've planned a forum for August 28th, where our chancellor will be co-convening with 6 other C-suite leaders, we've invited 6 other C-suite leaders to co-convene with him. They will be reaching out to a much broader group of C-suite folks to have a detailed discussion about where do we head, what goals has each institution set or each organization set, what's working, what isn't working, how can we collaborate more. And as we're currently very much in the process, and thanks to Gina for her support and the Second Nature team, thinking it through, we are we're looking at structuring it as an executive roundtable to start the day, followed by a series of more topically focused sessions with the deputies. And at some point, I'll look forward to being able to report back out and share some of the outcomes of this work. So we're just getting started, but we're thrilled to now be part of the UC3 cohort. And I think from here we've got maybe time for questions, or should we continue on with the program?
Yeah, thanks, Phil. Let's take one question. There was, and I'll address actually 2 questions. I'll address the first one. So one question was, when will cohort 2 of UC3 begin? The process is right now starting. So if you're interested as an institution, I think Heidi said this, do reach out to Gina. We're looking at most likely in the fall as an announcement for that second cohort. So most likely at the Climate Action Summit in September. So really think about the time frame over the next month and a half if you're interested in joining that second one. The more substantive question is about broader social engagement. And really the heart of the question is there an opportunity for UC3 and just maybe higher ed in general to build more social awareness, political will, through broader outreach to the rest of society in the places they're located, rather than just thinking about it as a research enterprise or a student-focused enterprise or a traditionally academic enterprise. So maybe the 2 folks from schools could respond to that. How have you thought about this cross-sector activity as a way to engage the, public writ large.
Well, Heidi here, I'll give a shot at that. It's at the heart of what we're doing. Again, social justice and equity is at the top of our list in all aspects of the work that we do on climate, really. And, you know, marrying the research is a key component. That's nice. But really, our platform as a convener is to bring together those sectors again to address all aspects of that, and equity certainly is at the top of the list. And that's when I mentioned that health is an interesting strategy. I think that cuts right to the heart of the matter too. So the agenda, you know, we're viewing our convening, by the way, that we're doing at the end of July, as the first in the series of many. And that ongoing discussion certainly will hopefully bear fruit in all aspects of climate justice.
That's great. And I know the ones that have existed, Phil, I don't know if you wanted to chime in here, but I know the ones that have existed already, the forms that have existed, many of them have public components to it. And I think even more explicit public engagement could be a part of the process moving forward. It is an evolving initiative. Phil, do you have any thoughts, quick thoughts before we move on to Stephen?
I will just quickly add that the 2017 summit that we hosted, the first day was was targeted at the public, and it was intended to really try to engage as many folks as who wanted to be at the table as possible. The second day we were pretty tactical in inviting in individuals that we knew to be content experts in a whole range of different areas. But we made sure to use day one to capture feedback from the public at large, so that the first thing that those content experts did on day two was to review and make sure that they were building their processes around what we'd heard from the public on day one.
Great.
And I'd like to just add very quickly, and as Heidi said, it is at the heart of everything. Like, that public engagement piece is at the heart of everything that UC3 is doing. And so, for instance, like Phil and WashU, they had one STL and had that public engagement. The Ohio State University also had WestFest, which was all about public engagement on these issues. So yeah, it's definitely at the heart.
So just for sake of time, I'll keep us moving forward. And we're gonna pivot a little bit in this last section. We have Stephen Ellis from Second Nature, who's a climate programs manager. He's gonna talk about resilience and our resilience work. We've launched this a couple years ago, and just now getting some data back on what campuses are doing around resilience. So Stephen, go ahead.
Thank you, Tim. All right, so as Tim stated, my name is Stephen Ellis, and I'm the Climate Programs Manager here at Second Nature. And so I'm majorly responsible for program assessment and retention for signatories of the President's Climate Leadership Commitments. So I'll be talking about some of the major highlights from the recently submitted resilience assessment from members of either the climate or resilience commitment. Excuse me. Next slide. So just to provide you a quick overview of the key implementation steps for climate and resilience commitment signatories, after signing, institutions are required to quickly submit their implementation profile and then begin to organize in order to create their campus community task force that will be focusing on resilience initiatives. Afterwards, they would be assessing the categories and the structure that exists in their campus and or community. So Second Nature then provides guidelines for how the assessment should be completed and what components to include. But each school is able to design their own process and choose their own indicators. So this past May, several schools completed and reported on their resilience assessment. And you can see on the right there the breakdown of those schools that reported. Next slide, please. So here, I just wanted to provide a quick spatial reference to show you the members that are a part of either the climate or resilience commitment. Those that you see there in orange are climate commitment signatories, and those that you see in teal are resilience commitment signatories. Next slide. So as a part of the resilience assessment report, schools are asked to identify some existing strengths and assets. Now, at Second Nature, we encourage these schools or signatories to start by thinking about their strengths instead of vulnerabilities, to be able to leverage the positive aspects that exist on their campus and or in their communities. So far, some of the common types of strengths identified by many schools were community engagement, campus community partnership, existing sustainable or well-adapted infrastructures, and natural resources and location. Also, throughout the report, about 75% of the schools explicitly mentioned some type of cross-sector collaboration. And so many of them talked about ways that they want to coordinate planning with their local government. Next, after the strengths, schools are asked to identify hazards and climate change impacts that are seen as the top vulnerabilities both now and in the future. For hazards, the three most commonly listed were flooding from rainfall, severe storms, and extreme heat. And by far the most common impacts for climate change identified are infrastructure failure and power outage. Next slide. Next slide, please. Okay. I think you might want to go back one slide. Thank you. So here we have some charts showing the complete responses from all the resilience assessments for the top hazards and top climate impacts. So drought and extreme cold were also of concern for many schools, as listed in the hazard section. As for the impact section, many schools also identified invasive species, loss of biodiversity, water insecurity, disease outbreak, and poor air qualities as threats. Next slide. So we think it's important for schools to consider the entire context for which they're operating when they're thinking about resilience. So we asked them to identify some existing exacerbating factors that may impact their ability to cope and respond positively to climate change. So here you'll see that the top existing factors were food insecurity and economic inequality. So schools were also required to create at least one indicator per the five dimensions of resilience that you see listed there. And because they were allowed to develop their own indicators, as a result, there is a large range of types or in types of indicators. Some of them were qualitative and some were also quantitative. But what we found is that some of types of these indicators were especially common. And these common indicators categories shows what schools are thinking about as a major importance in considering the measuring aspect of resilience on their campus and or in their community. Next slide. So moving forward, schools were asked to identify initial actions that they could take to increase resilience. Now, these actions would form the basis for their climate action plan, which would be the next report type that they would be submitting in the upcoming year. So I want to highlight a couple of example actions that were identified here in the cat the right-hand side of your screen, which were to work with city officials and municipal departments, as well as leveraging students and faculty research on vulnerabilities. And finally, another one that I think is very much related to the webinar here today, the presentation, is research and piloting solutions on campus. So with that, I will move on to the next slide, and I think we'll take some questions. Thank you.
Thanks, Stephen. That's a good overview. So I think that one of the takeaways from those data are just to consider both the overlap between what is happening in the We're Still in America's Pledge UC3 landscape and what we're hearing back from signatories. Like Stephen said, this was submitted to us. This first round of reports was May of this year. So this is really, it's both an emerging topic for us, but the field of resilience also is an emerging field. And these institutions are actually at the leading edge of helping shape what that field looks like. There's a lot, as many of you on the call probably know, with between 100RC and various foundations that are supporting resilience work, there's a lot of activity going on in climate resilience space. The more data we get back from folks on their priorities, the more that can help shape and inform what those actions can be. And it's actually really encouraging. It's kind of validating to the UC3 type of model to know that there are many campuses that are working collaboratively and are interested in continuing that collaborative action and working with their communities in the future. So let's just take I think we can do both at the same time. Gina, if that's okay, you had sent over one question about a lingering question about UC3. We'll take that. But then if other people have questions about the resilience work that Stephen just presented, feel free to do that. And if you have questions for Gina upon reflection of the rest of this conversation, please do send those on. So the one question that we had gotten was, will the focus of UC3 remain with research institutions in the future? And that's actually a fantastic question. The way Second Nature is oriented, we have a steering committee of roughly 20 presidents that that guide our work. And when President Napolitano initiated the UC3, we also went back to that steering committee and said, obviously, we're not just comprised of research institutions as higher ed. Is there interest in other institutional types also leading efforts according to their respective strengths? So if you're a liberal arts institution, maybe publishing in science is not the key metric for your faculty to know whether or not you're going to be a successful faculty member. It might be more how have you engaged creatively with the curriculum that you've presented. And so we have actually two other cohorts of presidents that have been working on and thinking about an inspiration of the UC3 model, but applying it to other institutional types. And those two other groups include liberal arts schools and two-year institutions, so community colleges. So it's more to come on that, but to answer the question directly, yes, there is interest. It is in an exploration phase. And again, love to put all the work on Gina. So if you're interested in finding out more about that, feel free to let Gina know.
Yeah, and I will put my email in the chat so you have it immediately. And we'll also send out all the contact information with the slides.
All right, anything else, Gina? You see? Okay, well, we wanna thank everybody. I know webinars are always one of those things it's hard to stick with until the end. And so we appreciate everyone's attention. I'm the worst at doing this MC because I never do it, but I think the slides will be shared eventually. I think we do send this out to people. Maybe someone else who knows better can tell an authoritative way of saying that. I believe we'll be sharing something with the attendees. So that will happen. And then just please do follow our work. We'll follow the work of We're Still In, of America's Pledge, of the Climate Leadership Network, and of UC3. We're all working towards a similar goal, and it's important and urgent work, and it's something that we here at Second Nature really appreciate the network filling in on. We're not as an organization, we're not the strength. The network is our strength. So if you're an institution, feel free to reach out to us directly about that. With that, we'll give you 6 minutes of your day back, and thanks everybody for attending.